In this video, let's compare both renderers V-Ray and Corona, and I will challenge both of them with the same very basic task and then compare which renderer is easier to set up and can get you a better result in shorter time. Alright, so I think I choose a very standard situation right here. So we have this car model and then we use an HDRI. So for the car model, I use this model right here that you can download from this website, so wirewheelsclub.com. There you can download the whole model completely for free, or you can pay a little bit of money and you will receive the same model, but with a whole, I think, lighting, shading setup, textures and so on. So you can choose that also if you want. And for HDRIs, I use this website here normally, so hdrihaven.com, where you can also download all the HDRIs that you might want to try out completely for free. So both links I will put down in the description and you can check it out by yourself. Let's first see how this process works in Corona. So I'm using latest version here of Corona, and then let's just start IPR. So we start our rendering right here and we get just our car in a purely white environment. So what are the steps now that we need to do in order to bring our HDRI inside? And the process is quite easy. You just go inside here and then you just load a Corona bitmap. And then I would just choose, for example, my HDRI. Let's choose this one here that I downloaded from hdrihaven.com. And now we have an HDRI in our scene and we have a lighting coming from this HDRI. We have reflections that come also from the HDRI and so on. So far so good. The problem is once we rotate around, we see that basically our car is kind of floating somewhere in our environment. So that of course doesn't really look realistic. So let's now try to see how we can change that. This process luckily is very easy. We just take the HDRI and instance it here into the material editor. And now we can see that the environment mode is set to spherical. So that has this unwanted effect that if I zoom in and out, my environment doesn't really change. So it's only changing when I rotate the camera. But if I zoom in and out, it appears that the car is growing or shrinking. And that's because this one is an infinitely far away sphere, which basically it doesn't matter how much I move in here, because it's infinitely far away, it doesn't really scale accordingly like what you should expect. So let's choose a different environment mode here, and there's this mode called Dome, and this one actually has a scaling in our scene. So you can see at the moment the scaling is quite small, just 250 centimeters, and that's something that we of course need to change. But now you can see if you zoom in and out, you can see everything moves together with our car like what you would expect it to. So you need to change then here the scaling of the scene in order to make it to give it like a realistic scale. So for me, for example, I would choose here something like 750 centimeters, and then if you zoom out, you see that this one now is the scale of our scene, and if you're inside this dome, then everything moves together. Like if you zoom in and out, you can see there's a parallax even happening here between the car and the background. And everything is now much better except the floor. We can see there's lots of distortions that are happening here on the floor, and that's where this parameter here comes into play. This camera height at the moment, it's set to 20 centimeters, and the HDI, when it was shot, it was placed on a tripod, and this tripod most definitely probably wasn't 20 centimeters away from the floor. So you need to guess or know the tripod height, and you can see if you change this parameter right here, then everything is already behaving much better. So for example, we could choose some height like 100 centimeters, and that means that the HDI was shot like 100 centimeters away from the floor, and then everything could be already fine. I think let's choose 150, and then I think in this case we have something that now in terms of scaling of the building, in terms of the floor, looks somewhat believable. So the only problem that we're still facing is that our car itself doesn't have a shadow, and that's something that we're gonna tackle now. So for the floor, I have this floor geometry right here. It's just a simple plane which uses this floor material here, just a standard Corona material. At the moment, you can choose, for example, a different color, and you can see that the floor is being reflected back into the car, and we have a shadow that's coming from our HDRI. But now, of course, we want to make this floor use the same one like from the HDRI, and that we can just do like this. If we just use a Corona shadow catcher material right here, you could choose a different background color, which of course is not really what we want. but we want to use our HDRI in here, just instance that in here as well. And then we just need to choose a different projection mode. So at the moment it's screen projection, but we want to use, of course, environment projection. And then as soon as we did this, we are totally done. So we have our environment, we can zoom in and out. Our environment is moving together with our car. We have a shadow that's coming from our HDRI. We have a shadow that's being reflected back into our car. We have an environment that's being correctly reflected back into our car. And basically now, the only thing that we need to do is to change different HDRIs and just explore the look of our scene. So for example, let's choose this HDRI right here. And as soon as I change that, you see everything is being updated. The color here of the shadow kind of matches here the shadow here. Yeah, everything works, looks, behaves really photographic, really photorealistic. And yeah, you could make some renderings from different distances, from different perspectives and so on. Let's choose another HDRI, for example, this one here or this hangar. Open this one. Yeah, and then immediately you can explore your scene. You can check around how your shaders are behaving. You can tweak your shaders and you can start to do actual look development on your shaders itself. So of course there is some kind of fakes that are happening with this kind of projection modes, which I'm going to show you now. So if you choose, so it works pretty good with floors which don't really have some very distinctive patterns that you would recognize. But for example, let's choose this one here that has some floor lines. So everything looks pretty good from a still frame, but or from one angle, but you can see there's these angles here that are happening in the floor geometry. So in the floor, you will have these angles and you can see that they are basically changing depending on the camera, right? So here the angle is going this side and here the angle is going that side, right? So, I mean, it's technically a fake, right? Because you're still projecting like a spherical HDRI on a dome geometry and of course not some actual geometry and so on. So yeah, you know that basically there are some restrictions, but I think for the main part, for the time that we used to set up this, yeah, you could make some pretty convincing renders from it. You could even make some small camera movements from it and so on. And yeah, you can just perfectly explore your shaders, choose different HDRIs, and yeah, really dive into now development of the shader. So now let's explore how this whole thing would translate to V-Ray. So now we're in V-Ray and let's reproduce exactly the same procedure. So I would first create a V-Ray light and then switch this one here to dome and then load in a V-Ray bitmap and then load exactly the same HDRI that I was using before, start the interactive rendering, and at the same time I'm already instancing my V-Ray bitmap into here, just calling it HDRI. And now we have exactly the same starting point like what we had in Corona. So the same problem also is there, that if you zoom in and out, then you can see your environment stays exactly the same size. The rotation is being taken into account, but the scaling, of course, because this one is an infinitely far away sphere, the same thing is again happening. So now what can we do to change that? And unfortunately, the answer is that in V-Ray, you actually can't do much. So the only thing that you can choose here is this crown projection, but let's first see if this mapping type is anything similar like in Corona. So you can choose these kind of different mapping types, which all don't really do the thing that we are looking for. So the only thing that you can choose here is spherical. And then you have this infinitely far away sphere, where basically your buildings would always look way too big compared to the size of your car, for example. And then let's choose ground projection. So that's basically the only option that V-Ray offers you to control the scaling of the dome. And this one only lets you control the lower half of the dome. So if you enable ground projection, you can see the only thing that's actually happening or changing is the ground itself. And now there's only this one radius parameter here where you can choose a different scaling for the floor. And let's try to find something that looks believable or looks like in a way that we can use it. But That's definitely not it. Let's choose 100. Yeah, that's definitely not it, because you can also see there's still lots of distortions happening right here. My buildings always look too big, and if you zoom in and out, you can see it only appears to be zooming on the ground, but the environment itself always stays exactly the same. So unfortunately, that is the only option that V-Ray offers you as an artist if you don't want to build some custom setup. So from my understanding, this kind of workflow is extremely not user-friendly, because now I show you what I actually have to do in order to recreate this whole thing manually and not use the tools that V-Ray kind of provides me. Now, to be fair, let's first see what would be the procedure to have a floor. So I have this floor geometry right here, same way like in Corona. And now, in order to make it a matte object, there are several ways to do it. I normally like to do this one here. You just tick this checkbox here, make it also matte for reflection and refraction, make the alpha contribution to -1, and then choose those two things here. And then the rest you just leave like this. And then first of all, you get like a black hole basically, because it's being cut away and reveals your background color. So whatever color you set up in here would be shown in this part here for the matte object. And then you just take the same HDRI in here, instance into here, and then you would get something that works. So I think this kind of process works similarly like in Corona, and I would say, yeah, that's not unnecessarily user unfriendly, but here the way with the ground projection definitely is. So let's double check again that there's nothing that we maybe accidentally forgot. So this value here we already discovered, but then we have those three values up here, and those basically just define where the projection center is happening. So at the moment it's happening here at 000, which is basically just below our car, but we could move, for example, the projection center like let's say 750 units here to the side, and then you would see the projection center now is happening here. So that's what those two values here would be doing, right? So now the projection center is somewhere over here. But the downside, of course, is that you lose like a ton of resolution, and it definitely doesn't really help in terms of like distortions, right? So those two here, if your subject is standing at the 000 position in your scene, should be also set to 0 and 0. And then this last parameter here basically just gives you the option to move the projection plane downwards, right? So you could choose -250. And then you have the same problem again like earlier, is that your car is basically sliding over the floor. I hope you can see it here. Let me move slowly. You can see that, yeah, now the car is not really grounded on the floor anymore and it's moving around, right? So there's not really any reason why you should change those values here, unless that your subject is standing at a totally different position. But then the easier way would be to just move your subject to the center of the scene. So those values here also don't really help you much. And then the only value that you have is this radius parameter here. And trust me, you basically can't really find any value that kind of looks believable, because like now, for example, the car looks like a toy car. We don't really have so crazy distortions happening, but the scaling is totally off. So we would need to choose a smaller value here. For example, I don't know, let's choose 150 or something. And yeah, I mean, there's just like distortions all over the place, and it's basically not usable at all. So those are all the tools that V-Ray gives you as an artist. And now I built like a custom setup, which basically emulates the whole procedure that Corona does. You can build like a custom setup, which I'm gonna show you now. Let me show you my solution that I came up with. And in case you know any better solution, please let me know. I would be really interested in that. But this one here is a solution that I constantly use, because I think it provides, at least for me, the best kind of result. So what you can see here is that basically I recreated exactly the same thing that Corona is doing already by default. I recreated that manually, right? So I have a scene in here where I can move around, I can zoom, and the environment is moving together with the camera, not like in the standard V-Ray ground projection where only the floor would be moving forward and everything else would stay the same in scaling. So I think like this way you can also here in the viewport see the whole result already. And I think for the most part, it's probably fine to do some nice preview renderings. If you want to have like perfect result, then of course it's still best to use backplates and then just put the car on top of the backplate and then comp everything together. So that would definitely give you like the best result. But I think like for discovering your model, discovering your shading and so on, I think this kind of approach works actually pretty good. Let's now discover a little bit about how the scene is done, but I won't go in very much detail in this video here because otherwise it will just make everything way too long. So if you wanna watch a bonus video about how all of this was set up very detailed, and you also wanna download the scene except the car you would need to download by yourself, then you can check out my Patreon. Link is in the description and you can find all of this stuff over there. So let's now check out briefly this scene here. So as said, the way is exactly the same way like in Corona. So if you zoom out, you can even see that you can kind of see like a mini world here appearing. And yeah, once you're in the dome, then everything kind of works like what you expect it to work like. So how is it being done? Basically quite simple. So let me just show you the setup right here. So I have this controller here around, which I can, for example, move around, and then the lighting updates, right? So I can move the light in all directions. Let me just move a little bit further away so it's easier to be seen. So you can, yeah, as I said, move everything around, all the reflections update, all the lighting updates and so on, right? You can scale everything. So that's also similar like in Corona, that you can scale and that by this way define the size of your object. So for example, this one, it would be too small right here. This size I think is kind of fits to the environment in terms of scale of the buildings and so on. And then you can also choose to define your projection on the floor, right? So I have this custom attribute here in the controller, and then you can use this to define your projection. So that's also similar like what is happening in Corona with adjusting this tripod height. I have it for 300 here in the scene because I feel like this way it kind of fits for this scene. And yeah, so that's basically how you can control the whole thing. And now let's unfreeze this layer so that we can select those two objects here because those are the main parts. And then I have also a light, and then I have another thing that I want to show you later. So first of all here, let's talk firstly about the light. So let's hide all of this first, and then this one here is a standard dome light, and inside here I just use a V-Ray bitmap set to spherical, and this one is driving my diffuse and also my specular and reflections. But actually we don't really need this here, so we can also switch off this one and this one. And then we can see we only get the lighting contribution from here because everything else is coming here from my dome itself, right? So I have here this dome that's two different geometries, one for the environment here, that one uses a V-Ray light material and uses a projection to project V-Ray light material with this HDRI map in here. And then you can, yeah, it will drive the reflections, and it will also be responsible for the primary visibility. So we see this geometry here, we also see here in the viewport or in the rendering, and then also the it also reflects correctly here on my car. And then in order to have a floor, in order to have a shadow, I have this additional geometry down here, which you can see here, this blue one, and this one just uses normal V-Ray material with like a opacity fall off. So I have this opacity fall off here, which basically is blending over into my environment. And then, yeah, I will get this shadow here on the floor. And by using those two things here, basically the only reason to use this dome light here is for diffuse lighting, because unfortunately, once you have this dome here in place and this one is driving the reflections, in later V-Ray versions, the specular cannot go through this geometry here. So in earlier V-Ray versions, which is basically the way that I preferred a lot, was that the specular could go through the geometry, right? So for example, if you see this scene here, there's a specular now, but the reason why the specular is there is because of this light. Let me just turn this off. So if I just have this environment here and I just turn on all of this here. So my dome light, I don't have a specular, but if I hide my dome here, suddenly I have a specular again, right? And that is actually the problem that was, from my understanding or from my feeling, introduced in later VRare versions for whatever reason. They changed the way that you cannot affect your speculars and reflections independently from each other. So now basically they are kind of linked, and since here there is a geometry already here, which basically shows up in my reflections, the specular that is coming from the dome light that I want to see is unfortunately not going through. So I have this additional light right here. So this light I just positioned roughly or exactly at the position of where the sun is in the HDRI, and then this one is driving my specular. So once I have this light in here and I switch it on, you will see that now I have a specular again back on my car. So that's the reason why I have this one extra light here. You can also see it, so if I have this specular layer here and I move this light a little bit outside of my dome geometry, then suddenly I don't have any specular anymore. So that's the reason why I use this light. I said in earlier V-Ray versions that's not really necessary, and the light for the specular here from the dome light would go through this geometry. So I was testing it out in V-Ray 3.6, but from what I read in 4.3, this behavior was unfortunately changed. I'm not a very huge fan of this. I would much more prefer if everything would be behaving more like how I did traditionally, because I don't see any particular benefit to have it working the way it's working at the moment. But yeah, that's unfortunately the case. So that's why you need to add this extra additional light in here. All right, I hope you enjoyed this little run through of my personal workaround to get around all of those inconveniences that are actually unfortunately present in V-Ray. At the end, I just want to say that I've been using V-Ray for a very long time. It's been with me basically every workday for the last 10 years. I really enjoy to use it. I really enjoy its flexibility. It's just that sometimes when you try out some other renderers and you see how user-friendly they basically are, it kind of frustrates you a little bit about why stuff like this can't just be easily in V-Ray. So from my feeling, somehow I feel oftentimes stuff for V-Ray is looked at more from a technical perspective, like how it is technically absolutely correct, but you as an artist, you don't want to deal with like these kind of complicated custom solutions, right? So in Corona, basically it was just a matter of three clicks and you got something that basically looks good, behaves good. You can immediately work, you can immediately focus on the stuff that you care about, which is like developing the look, developing the shaders and so on. And here in 3ds Max and V-Ray, you would need to spend, I think, at least 30 minutes to build like this kind of custom setup, and you will need to have the knowledge to do it. So that's what I feel like oftentimes beginner maybe find V-Ray a little bit frustrating to get some nice result. So yeah, I hope this workaround here shows you a little bit or helps you a little bit to get some nicer results from V-Ray out of the box. And yeah, until then, I hope you take care of yourself, stay safe, and see you soon. Bye-bye.